I love books, but there is one giant frustration that has followed me throughout life, which is all these dense, big, complicated books, and most of them for me are on philosophy, that I just can't seem to finish. They're like a mirage in a desert for me. It's right there. I can read the words, but somehow my brain cannot process, and the closer I go to it, the quicker it disappears. I go through this emotional roller coaster of, here's hope. I can understand the wisdom. I can absorb it into me. And then here's reality. I can't. I haven't. What do I do with this? If you experience that, your life is about to fundamentally change, because ever since I started reading with ChatGPT, probably, I don't know, for at least 6 months now, it has completely changed how I view books, how my curiosity actually expanded. So let me show you at least 5 use cases you can use now to improve your reading experience with your curiosity reading buddy, ChatGPT. All you have to do is go to ChatGPT, click on the headphone icon to turn on voice chat. Now, the first thing you can use ChatGPT for is if you're reading something that has a concept you don't understand, get ChatGPT to answer it. That's pretty simple. Let's take Gotta Escherbach as an example. This is a book I've started and I thought I would finish by now, but anyway, here I am still reading this. And there are a lot of concepts in here that I don't know or I've heard of, but my understanding is very superficial. So I've been going to ChatGPT a lot. For example, he talks about canons and fugues by Bach and how that structure and the difference in the structure between the two is essential for understanding consciousness, meaning, beauty. And so let me go to ChatGPT and ask about this. Please give me a concise definition to canons and fugues by Bach. What is the significance of fugues and how does it differ from canons? Keep your answers to 3 to 5 sentences.
While canons are stricter in their repetition, fugues allow for more freedom and development in how the theme evolves.
Very simple, we get definitions, some context. If we want more, we can ask for more. But I actually like use case number 2, which is confirming whether my understanding is correct. So with this canon fugue business, as ChatGPT was talking about how you have more fluidity, you have more creativity at play, it reminds me of the difference between poetry and maybe regular writing, in the sense that poetries are a lot less rigid, there's more expressiveness. And I want to confirm, is that analogy correct? Have I gotten the essence of the difference between canons and fugues? So let's give it a try. So can you draw a comparison between canons and fugues as well as writing and poetry, maybe even nonfiction writing and poetry, in terms of that structure, fugues being more fluid, having more creativity? Is that a fair comparison?
Yes, that's a fair and insightful comparison. In terms of structure, canons are like nonfiction writing. They follow a strict, predictable form, much like how nonfiction adheres to facts, evidence, and a clear logical flow. There's less room for deviation, as both focus on precision and replication, whether it's the melody in a canon or the clear presentation of information in nonfiction. On the other hand, fugues are more akin to poetry, where there's greater fluidity and creativity within a structured form. A fugue, like a poem, introduces a theme and then develops it through variations, echoes, and creative interplay among the voices. It still has structure and rules, but within that framework, there's room for imagination, emotion, and complexity. Much like how poetry can evoke deeper meaning and multiple interpretations while maintaining a certain rhythm or form.
Okay, that's good. The analogies seem to have made sense. But now I want to move on to the third use case, which is, so what? Right, okay, I understand what canons and fugues are. I even came up with something that confirmed my understanding is there. But then, so what? Like, what's the significance of this? So let's go to ChatGPT and ask about this. I don't know, what is the significance of this structure that Hofstadter points out?
The significance of the difference between canons and fugues, especially in the context of Hofstadter's work, is in how they symbolize different approaches to thought and expression. Canons, with their rigid repetition, represent logical consistency and predictability, much like nonfiction writing. They show how a single idea can be repeated or mirrored exactly, emphasizing structure and clarity. In contrast, fugues embody flexibility and creativity within a system. The theme in a fugue evolves, shifts, and interplays between voices, suggesting that ideas can transform while still maintaining coherence. Hofstadter points out these structures because they illustrate different ways the mind engages with complexity. Sometimes through rigid frameworks, canons, and sometimes through adaptive interplay, fugues. It mirrors the tension between order and creativity, or certainty and ambiguity, which is central to how we process and express deep ideas.
This is so helpful. Now I have the so what. I have the significance of why we're even talking about this in my head as I go through the rest of the book. And this will help me make those connections between ideas that I talk about in all that note-taking stuff. Now, as you're going through this process, what you'll find is you can't help but connect what you're learning now to what you already know or what you care about. For me, it's polymathy, it's the relationship between creativity and logic. And it seems like this is exactly what we're talking about with GEB. So I want to go in further, talk about this idea with ChatGPT and get it to suggest to me some other resources I should read in order to understand this concept from maybe multiple sources, different authors, find new books to read. So let's get to ChatGPT and ask it what we can do. Seems like the interplay of logic, creativity, is essential. Can you give me maybe three more books that talk about this concept of the complementary nature of creativity and logic?
Absolutely. The interplay of logic and creativity is a rich area of study that cuts across various fields. Here are three books that explore this complementary relationship in unique ways. One, Zen and the Art of Motorcycle Maintenance by Robert M. Persig. This philosophical novel delves deeply into the balance between classical, logical, rational understanding of the world and romantic, intuitive, creative perspectives. Persig contrasts these two approaches, emphasizing that a full understanding of life requires integrating both. His exploration of quality as a concept that transcends logic but still informs rationality mirrors the ideas in GB regarding how creativity and logic are interdependent for deeper meaning. 2. Thinking Fast and Slow by Daniel Kahneman. Although primarily focused on cognitive science and decision-making, Kahneman discusses how the mind operates in two systems. System 1, which is fast, intuitive, and creative, and System 2, which is slower, logical, and deliberate. The tension and interaction between these two systems reflect the relationship between creativity and logic, with creativity often driving quick, original insights, while logic evaluates and refines these insights. This dual process theory can be likened to how fugues and canons represent different forms of thought. 3. The Act of Creation by Arthur Koestler. Koestler explores how creativity often arises from the intersection of different modes of thought, what he calls bisociation, where two unrelated frames of reference, one often logical, the other more creative, collide to produce new ideas. This mirrors Hofstadter's use of recursion and self-reference, where multiple layers of meaning emerge from the interplay of logical structures and creative interpretation. Koestler's work is foundational in understanding how creativity and logic complement each other in problem-solving and innovation. These books, like Gödel, Escher, Bach, show that creativity and logic are not opposites, but are deeply intertwined, with each enhancing the other to form a complete cognitive toolkit for navigating complex ideas.
Before I go and get more books that I may or may not read, the next use case, which I also love, is now that I have a concept that I can grasp, I can talk about, at least to some degree, I want to get it to help me make some connections between the books I have yet to read, or ones that I have started to, but I haven't gotten very far, to see, can I build on these concepts with what I have in my library? So let me ask it. Are there any connections between GEB and Aristotle's Nicomachean Ethics?
Here are a few specific ideas in Aristotle's Nicomachean Ethics that relate to the interplay of logic and creativity. 1, the doctrine of the mean. Aristotle's concept of the golden mean is the idea that virtue lies between excess and deficiency. This balance can be seen as a metaphor for balancing creativity and logic. Just as Aristotle advises against extremes, Hofstadter and GEB explores how consciousness, self-reference, and meaning arise from the tension between formal systems, logical rigid, and human intuition or creativity, more flexible and open-ended. 2. Phronesis, practical wisdom.
And before we get to phronesis, as we're doing this, I realize, okay, Nicomachean ethics is actually not as hard as I thought because I've already read about it. I've read about it in Great Thinkers, and I actually referenced it in one of my YouTube videos. And so this is why, to me, having ChatGPT, who has access to so many resources, can help me make the connections, can help make all of these big, thick books less intimidating. And while there are hundreds, thousands, millions of more use cases you can do with ChatGPT, I found these 5 simple things brought so much more joy, so much more curiosity out of me. You know, I have someone to talk to about this without needing to give context, without needing to go deep into what is the book about, you know, explaining things and confusing others. I can take my raw thoughts, tell ChatGPT in its raw form, and it will understand what I'm saying or ask me to refine and give me the information that I need, and then some, so I can go explore further, go down rabbit holes. This really fundamentally changed how I read, how I learn. Let me know how you like this. Let me know if you have other use cases that you're really enjoying when it comes to reading books. And I will see you in the next video. Bye!